Greetings. I received another great question. Should the Old Testament be ignored? Here is my answer with expanded scripture references from my original message. That is a great question, brother. The Old Testament actually describes God's establishment of the Old Covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. As such, it reveals so much it is critical to learn and understand. The Old Testament is the foundation which God established, foretelling that God would visit His own temple as a prophet. Isaiah 40 verse 3, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, this is the word Yahweh, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. So prophet Isaiah reveals a voice would announce God in the earth. Matthew 3:3, this is He, speaking of John the Baptist, who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for Him. Prophet John is identified as the voice who will announce God in the earth. Malachi 3:1, behold, I will send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to His temple, and the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. Prophet Malachi foretells Prophet John, who comes before God to prepare the way for God. So Isaiah 40 verse 3, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Matthew 3:3, this is He who was spoken of, prepare the way for the Lord. Malachi 3:1, behold, I, Yahweh, send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me, God. Prepare the way for the Lord. Prepare the way for the Lord. He will prepare the way before me. Behold, just how clear the message of the prophets is. And that is why certain statements are made. In 1 John 4:2, by this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses Jesus Christ having come in the flesh is of God. Why say, having come in the flesh? Does it make sense to think this questions whether Jesus was an actual person who actually lived? No. Of course there was a real person named Jesus who was crucified on the cross. The real meaning is whether Jesus was God come in the flesh. And the book of John is crystal clear that Jesus was the Word of God, one with God, and was made into flesh. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Jesus, the Word of God, was with God in the beginning, meaning before creation. Jesus even confirms this later, meaning Jesus knew of His existence with God before creation. John 17:5, and now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world came to be or existed. John 1:3, all things came into being through Him, Jesus, and apart from Him, nothing came into being that has come into being. Jesus, the Word of God, is the Creator. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There came a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify about the light, so that all might believe through him. He, John, was not the light, but he, John, came to testify about the light. Isaiah, Malachi, and now the apostles agree. John is the voice. He, Jesus, was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. The maker of heaven and earth came for a visit, and creation did not recognize him. Sadly, Jesus states there was a consequence for not recognizing God visiting Israel. Luke 19:43, "For the days will come upon you when your enemies will barricade you and surround you and hem you in on every side. They will level you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God." He came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. They were born of God. Being born of God means being born again. Being born again needs a whole video to itself. "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth." So God, the maker of heaven and earth, came in the flesh, as the prophets foretold. That is revealed in the Old Testament. So the short answer is no, it should not be ignored. However, that would not be a complete answer. God said through Moses that through Abraham's offspring all nations would be blessed. Genesis 22:18, "In your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice." God then began to reveal by the prophets that he would bring a new, better covenant. "Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. But this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and on their heart I will write it, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Romans 11:27, "For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins." Jesus spoke of making this new covenant by shedding his own blood. Mark 14:24, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. Luke 22:20, "In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." The Apostle Paul also taught this because Jesus appeared to Paul and taught Paul. 1 Corinthians 11:23, "For I received from the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus in the night in which he was betrayed took bread. And having given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." This speaks of the new covenant which Jesus established, It is documented in the New Testament. It was established by Jesus shedding his blood, just as Abraham made the first shedding the blood of animals. More critical knowledge from the Old Testament that explains the New Testament or New Covenant. Genesis 15:9. The Lord responded, "Bring me a 3-year-old cow, a 3-year-old female goat, a 3-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon." So Abram brought him all these animals and cut each of them in half down the middle, placing the pieces opposite each other, but he did not cut the birds in half. Christians have a covenant with God that is described in the New Testament. Hebrews 12:24. To Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. Hebrews 8:6. But in fact, the ministry Jesus has received is as superior to theirs as the covenant of which he is a mediator is superior to the old one, since the new covenant is established on better promises. 1 Timothy 2:5. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus. For us, it is important to learn the details and terms of the old covenant because it foretells the second. The Old Testament prophets foretold the coming of the Son of God. They also foretold God himself coming to the earth. The prophets reveal God, our Redeemer. Hebrews 9:15. Therefore Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, now that he has died to redeem them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. So Christians should not ignore the Old Testament. However, we are not bound to obey the rituals and restrictions. Romans 5:21. So that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace might reign through righteousness to bring eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 6:14. For sin shall not be your master, because you are not under law but under grace. Romans 8:2. For in Christ Jesus the law of the Spirit of life has set you free from the law of sin and death. The Bible teaches us that sin is master over the human beings. It is our master because we must obey our sinful desires. But Jesus sets us free from the control of sin. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Romans 7:4. So, my brothers and sisters, you also died to the law through the body of Christ, that you might belong to another, to him who was raised from the dead, in order that we might bear fruit for God. Christians now belong to him who was raised from the dead. Galatians 5:18. But if you are led by the Spirit, meaning the Holy Spirit, you are not under the law. Romans 8:14. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons or children of God. Take one example, food. In the Old Testament, God called many things unclean, like pork. But in the New Testament, God says he has made such things clean. Acts 10:13. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." And the voice spoke unto him again the second time, "What God has cleansed, do not call unclean." This was done 3 times, and the vessel was received up again into heaven. So the distinction is that the new covenant does not compel submission to the old covenant. The new covenant is actually more strict. Pray without ceasing. Do not lust after a woman. Do not hate your fellow man. The Old Covenant prevented actions which were sinful. The New Covenant demands attitudes be controlled and purified as our worship of God. In fact, the Old Covenant, or the Law, the Torah, was given to teach us that we were sinful. Galatians 3:23, before this faith came, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until faith should be revealed. Galatians 3:24, so the law became our guardian or tutor, schoolmaster, to lead us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. Romans 10:4, Christ is the culmination of the law, so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Galatians 3:25, now that this faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. So the Old Covenant and Law were for a time, before Christ came. And after Christ was crucified and resurrected, the gospel was spread by Jesus to the Gentiles by Paul. Acts 9:15, but the Lord said to Ananias, go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. Ephesians 3:1, for this reason I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. Ephesians 3:8, although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given to me, to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ. Romans 15:8, for I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the Jews on behalf of God's truth, to confirm the promises made to the patriarchs, so that the Gentiles may glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles, I will sing hymns to your name. Which fulfills 2 Samuel 22:50, therefore I will praise you, Lord, among the nations, I will sing the praises of your name. Romans 3:29, or is God the God of the Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles too? Yes, of Gentiles too. I hope that makes sense, brother. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.